Many of you already know that I have just returned from a trip to that place we call the Holy Land. I have been in Israel and I've been in Palestine. We saw the Sea of Galilee and the region of Galilee where Jesus spent most of his ministry. We saw Bethlehem and the surrounding area that is Palestine, and we ended the week with a few days in Jerusalem, often called the Holy City, what is certainly the most contested, what is arguably the most contested place on earth. And as you might expect, it was a place I was very grateful to be able to go. It was an experience that was part pilgrimage, part educational. It was particularly helpful to see things like the Sea of Galilee and the terrain that surrounds it. I have a much better visual idea of the places where Jesus spoke and taught and healed. It was extremely helpful to become aware in a way I'd never been before about the proximity of the places where Jesus is reported in the Gospels to have spoken and where people gathered around him. And now to actually have an image of what a mountain or a high mount looks like in those places and what one might see from it. The kinds of locations that people lived. Some of the archaeological sites were particularly helpful. And for example, there's a town called Magdal. And some of you will know that town, even if you don't know you know that town, because you've probably had the words Mary Magdalene come from your lips. And that's the town where she is purported to have come from. There is an archaeological site there. It's very recent. They've only in the last few years discovered it. And in that archaeological dig, they discovered a synagogue. And while it was not a synagogue that we know Jesus went to, it's not a synagogue that Jesus is reported to have been at as the one in Capernaum is, but it is, they were able to, you know, discover a first century synagogue, and to see the layout, it will forever and permanently change the way that I view that moment in Luke's gospel where Jesus reads the text in the synagogue, because it is so much smaller than I'd ever imagined. And so these sorts of things were profoundly useful to me. And then there were other times where it was less educational and it really sort of leaned more into the pilgrimage experience. We saw a number of shrines, places that are purported to be where Jesus did something or said something. Now, some of these places are very purported, if you know what I mean. Some of them have been signs of Christian veneration for a very, very long time. And some of them don't look at all like what they might have looked like in Jesus' time, because they have been turned into a shrine and a church, or many churches have been built over the site. You can really no longer tell what that place might have looked like in the first century. Some of these places feel very, very special, and some of them feel very chaotic. And all of this experience, I think, will permanently inform my thinking, my teaching, and my preaching for the rest of my life, which is a fancy way of saying y'all are going to hear a lot about this for a while to come. As we went from place to place and met with so many different kinds of people and observed pilgrims from so many other places, a question began to form for me. And I bring that question to you today with some of the thoughts that I have begun to think. But I bring it to you not because I have an answer to give you, but because I hope we can begin together to have a conversation. And that question is this: what makes some place holy? The place I went is often shorthanded as the Holy Land. But the truth is, it is, as I said, arguably the most contested place on earth. It's a place religious people have fought over since, you know, God was a boy. It is the place where we continue to struggle, and where I actually saw some of that struggle take place in my very presence. What makes some place holy? Was it because something happened there a long, long time ago? And really, what even does a long, long time ago mean for some of us? We're really terribly proud, and I think rightfully so, of the fact that we are the OG of Methodist churches on this continent, and we're 250 years old, and we think that's very grand, and I concur. But the truth is, I also was in the fourth oldest church in the world earlier this week, and it put things in a little bit of perspective. So what makes some place holy? What brings us to locations and places? And what are the things we do to those places that make them holy or make them not? The holiest place I went to, the place where I felt the presence of God the most, the place where I truly had a sense of the holiness of God and the reverence that we ought to offer God, was not at a shrine, not at a place where Jesus is said to have done anything on that exact spot. It was a center run by Palestinian Christians in Bethlehem. And it was located right next, and I mean right next, to the wall that the state of Israel has built to segregate parts of Palestine. And at this center, known as the Wuhan Center, they work for conflict resolution. They work with individuals and families and communities to help people who have internalized to a tremendous degree the oppression that exists for them and in which they live. And it's showing up in relationships and in families and in marriages and in neighborhoods. And they work in an extended way to bring dignity to people, to resolve conflict, to heal families. It's a remarkable thing that they do. They have a summer camp every year for hundreds of Palestinian children. And they work with women to help them to function effectively and to know their own worth and their own dignity. And it was remarkable to be in conversation with the man who founded that center and his adult son who works with him there, who has 2 master's degrees in finance and chooses to live next to a wall that segregates him from many of his people. It was a holy place because the work is a holy work. Also, forever imprinted in my memory is this little church in Jenin, which is in Palestine. And it is a Eastern Rite Catholic Church. And for 25 years, it sat dormant because the the priest who had run it had died. And in the Eastern Rite Catholic Church, priests can get married. That's why this story makes sense. The priest who directed it died. And for 25 years, they didn't send another priest. And eventually his grandson was finally able to be sent there, and he was able to restart this church. It's a very humble church. It doesn't look like any of the fancy shrine churches I went to. It's not exorbitantly built. It's not grand. But they run a school where Palestinian children, both Christian and Muslims, attend peacefully together. And that's a story you don't often hear, but I saw. And it's a holy work, and it's a holy place. Jenine is also the place where 2 days later, a Palestinian Christian journalist was shot and killed. Doing the work of bringing the truth to bear about the situations that continue to pervade this, the holiest place on earth, or the Holy Land. Hers was a holy work as well. To me, these experiences, these places, these locations, this little kind of rough-hewn church, they were more meaningful to me than some of the shrines I visited, which had grand buildings on them, to which many, many pilgrims came. The two places I've mentioned, not very many people visit them. Part of that is by design, by the Israeli government, and hence that wall that I talked about. You know, there were a number of places where Jesus was purported, and as I said, some of them are very purported, to have done some great work, some miracle, some important teaching. And in those places, people come, and lovely buildings have been built, and they charge you to use the restrooms, and they're very, very ready to sell you an icy or a Coke or a tchotchke. There are a number of places where you have to have your knees and your shoulders covered to go in, where that is not sacred or holy, your knees or your shoulders, but commerce and commercialism and making money is. And I thought, what makes a place holy? For many Christians, the holiest place they can imagine is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It is the place that some believe was the site of both the crucifixion and the tomb where Jesus was laid. Now, because many people believe this is the place and therefore the place for Christians, you know, the natural thing to do, right, is to fight about it. And so there are five different churches that kind of coexist there, but not really. And they squabble and fight and tussle with each other about what happens in that place. And thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people come and are rushed through the shrines and the locations of where things happened. And it is utterly chaotic. And there's just noise, and it's in, you know, big grand buildings, the noise, bounces. And it was just a lot to process for me. And it was so fast and so much was happening. And I was, not sure what to do with this place. But it's there that I got my favorite preaching story, which is a way of saying you're going to hear this more than once. My favorite preaching story from this trip it is about how these five different churches were the Roman Catholic Church, the Greek Orthodox Church, the Coptic Church, the Armenian Church, and the Egyptian Church, how they come together in this place and attempt to coexist, often not successfully, so unsuccessfully that there is a ladder at the entrance to the building that has been there for more than 100 years, but they can't agree to move it. And nobody knows who put it there. They can't agree who put it there. They can't agree to move it. And so there it sits, leaning against a window, bearing witness to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. As you can imagine, these churches have a hard time agreeing on lots of things. And one of the things they cannot agree on is who should have the keys to the joint. And they fought over it to such a degree that a long time ago, somebody decided that the keys would be held by a local Muslim family. And so for generations, somebody from this family has unlocked the Church of the Holy Sepulchre each morning and locked the Church of the Holy Sepulchre each night. Because the Christians could not agree on how to open and close this sacred and holy place. One of the things I'm thinking is that what makes a place holy is what we do with it and who and how we are there. What makes a place holy is our response to injustice and oppression, is our intentional, purposeful hopefulness in the face of harm and loss and grief and violence. What makes a place holy is who and how we are in those places, not what happened only long, long ago, not the dim memory of what might have been, but the way that the resurrection continues to be present in our midst and the way we live out and become signs of the resurrection in dark and frightening moments. When Moses is called to a holy place, that place of the burning bush, his response is, "Here I am." And it strikes me that place is holy not only because of the presence of God, but because Moses responds to the presence of God by raising his hand and by going where he is sent with the message that he has been sent by God. What makes a place holy is our willingness to raise our hands, to receive a call, to sense a purpose, and to make ourselves available to that purpose and to go where we are needed, even when it is frightening and challenging, even when it is difficult, even when it is dangerous. To name those places where oppression and injustice exists and to respond with confidence and hope. Here I am. I am has sent me. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.